Okay, we have two special guests here today. We have Wesley Keller and Franklin Urquhart, and we're here to discuss Libertarian Party and the libertarianism. Or how else would you say that?
I'd say it like
is that. Pretty much like that? Libertarianism and
Libertarianism the party? And the Libertarian Party as two separate subjects and how they coalesce.
Okay.
And our experience at the 2021 Libertarian Convention.
Okay, so you guys, so what you're saying is that you attended their convention?
Yes. Two Saturdays ago.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay,
yeah,
so
a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, okay. Couple weeks.
All right, now how did you come about this event? I mean, who told you about it and why did you
go? We actually got invited by someone.
Yeah, right. Through our Facebook.
Okay, so you're not naming names, you're just saying
no, someone who is involved with the Libertarian Party, who is a libertarian, invited us.
Okay.
They reached out to our account, our Molon Lave Truth account on Facebook.
Okay.
And invited us. It started out, they asked us who we were through Messenger, as so many people who friend us do. They ask who we are. So we explained that we're a group. And we do music and news reporting and skits and stuff like that. And so they asked if we were a group based out of Kansas. And so we said, yes, we're a group based out of Kansas. And they're like, oh, okay, do you want to come to the Libertarian Party Convention in Manhattan, Kansas on May 1st? And we're like, yeah, because you've expressed a great interest in the Libertarian Party for a while.
Yep.
And so I felt like it was very apropos that we were asked to go.
Okay, and the candidate that they had up for the presidential election was
Joe Jorgensen was their presidential candidate,
mm-hmm. And you voted for
it. I did, okay. I did actually.
All right, so they felt like you guys, mm-hmm. based on the information that you put out on your group page,
mm-hmm.
actually have several pages.
Mm-hmm.
They felt like you would be a good candidate to maybe attend
mm-hmm.
their event, which is their big convention,
mm-hmm.
and learn about their platform.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you did go.
Yes, mm-hmm. we did.
Okay.
We made the long, perilous drive to Manhattan, Kansas. And we're completely neutral going into this. We're completely open-minded. We have no preconceived notions of anything. We're like, you know, I mean, you've done some research into it. You know what their official principles, their mission statement, so to speak, is. And so that gave me a frame of mind of what to expect. And I'm familiar with the Libertarian Party through proxy because mm-hmm. I've always heard people talking about it. And I know that just libertarianism in and of itself is, you know, basically what the majority of Americans are. They want less government mm-hmm. and
minimal government, maximum freedom.
Yeah.
Or maximum liberty.
Yeah, maximum liberty. Because liberty supersedes freedom. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, that's all good so far. And so we made the trip. And, it was, I was really happy because we also took our petition with us to our physical version of our petition to return Kansas to physical hand-counted ballots.
Oh, okay, so this is concerning election.
Yeah, this is concerning election.
Integrity, yeah.
Yeah, so we get there, and we immediately ask some people if they want to sign our petition, and we got some signatures.
Yeah, we got quite a few signatures.
Really?
And I thought we would, because, most libertarians are going to believe in free and fair elections.
Yeah.
You know, I mean.
So when you did that, you got the feeling that they believed that the election was fraudulent, wouldn't you say, or not?
At least had an understanding that something needed to be done. Many of the people, maybe half the people signed half the people we asked signed our petition, and the other half just said, nah, I'm not going
to
do that.
Yeah, there were quite a few people that said that they needed to think about that one because they weren't sure if they believed in the idea of going back to strictly paper ballots. But another thing about the Libertarian Party is most libertarians do not like Trump. Mm-hmm. And because this election has to do with Donald Trump, I think a lot of them were kind of hesitant because of that. But
that has, you know, repercussions going forward.
But most of the libertarians that signed our petition, they seemed very, the vibe that I got from them anyway was yes, absolutely. We need to make sure we have election integrity.
Yeah, and just the faces that we met, we got into candid conversations with a number of lively people, and that was really cool. There were, you know, quite a few individuals who were very knowledgeable and, you know, educated on various subjects, and we had very interesting conversations with each of those individuals.
Yeah.
Wow, that would have been exciting.
Mm-hmm.
Just by that alone, you find out that you have really some variety within the Libertarian Party.
Yeah. Oh, there's a wide range of variety. That's so putting it mildly.
You have people in there who, since they did have a candidate running for president, they probably feel cheated because they're not part of the process. They really aren't.
Right.
Libertarians are.
Yeah.
It's Republican or Democrat, or basically now communists.
Yes.
And conservative.
Yeah, pretty much.
Which one are you going to choose? And libertarians don't really have a chance to win an election.
Yeah.
It's rare because of the two-party paradigm that they call it.
Well, and they just don't have enough support. And we can get to the reason why they don't have more support later.
Okay.
First, I just want to speak to all the positives that we took away. For me, I really enjoyed the individuals that we talked to. Mm-hmm. However, they were members of the Libertarian Party, but their knowledge seemed to span outside of the Libertarian Party. We spoke to an individual who has lived in many different states and has, you know, and has migrated to Kansas. He was incredibly knowledgeable. Mm-hmm. We spoke to another individual who was incredibly well researched about, you know, the past and World War II and you know, the ramifications of
his family. That guy you're talking about, his family actually lived in the Weimar Republic in Germany right before the Nazis took over, and he was telling us about, well, you know, the gun control thing. That's exactly what the Nazis did, and you know, well, actually, it was gun registration is what he was talking about.
That's where it started.
Gun registration. Yep. That's what the Nazis started doing. Yep. You know, they said, "Give us your guns if you want all this gang violence to stop," and that's exactly what they did. And then, sure enough, you know, a few years later, they lost their gun rights.
Yep.
They couldn't defend themselves, and that's when the Nazis started, you know,
yep,
marching down their streets.
You know. No, you did it wrong.
Yeah. We got you.
We got you. But I was very, very appreciative. He was the second person we talked to when we first got there to the Blue Mont Hotel.
And he had a lot to say.
Yeah, he had a lot to say. It was super, super educational. It was awesome. Wow. And we talked with, you know, like I said, quite a few people there, and they were all knowledgeable. But yeah, those individuals especially, they were libertarians, but they were probably more worldly than
some of the other ones.
Yeah. And so they might be libertarian in their party association, but they're more worldly. And that made them incredibly impressive. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm expecting from the Libertarian Party, you know, Full Sail, are people like them.
Mm-hmm.
Because, it's one thing to believe in libertarianism, which we all do. You know, all three of us here believe in libertarianism. Like I said, most Americans are libertarian in their values. You know, just because you slap libertarian on your party as its name, that doesn't make your party immediately libertarian in its values. The people in the party have to maintain those libertarian values.
Or they're not libertarian anymore.
It doesn't, like how the Republican Party, there are so many rhinos, you know, Republicans in name only, that party with all these rhinos, they're not Republicans anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
There's something else. If you were to list the positives, how would you list them? I mean, what would
you list your positives?
Overall, I was very, very impressed with their convention. But one of the major positives that I took away from the experience. There was one particular guy I talked to about the mask mandates, because he was talking about how he used to be a, I'm not sure if he said he still was or if he used to be, but he was a business owner himself. And he was talking about how, well, I was expressing my anger or whatever, you know, like, because we actually walked around the motel just kind of doing some sightseeing and stuff, and we looked at all these bars and restaurants and everything. Every single one of them, you have to wear a mask to come in. So needless to say, we didn't go in and do anything.
Might I add, though, that the Bluemont Hotel did not have a mask
mandate. They did not have a mask mandate. Really?
So
which was nice. Yeah, commend them, definitely.
The Bluemont Hotel, 10 out of 10, would do again.
Do you think that's why the Libertarian Convention was in that?
Probably. Because the vast majority... Most of the libertarians were not even wearing masks. There were a few that were wearing masks, but it seemed like all of them were anti-mask mandate.
Mm-hmm. And by the time the convention started back up in the afternoon, they all took their masks off.
Yeah,
the few that actually were wearing some.
So you've got the intellectual capacity of these people.
Yep.
Not all, but the ones you ran into, they had a really good grasp on their history, a pretty good idea of what liberty really meant and why we have it here. Yep. And then you talked about...
You were going back into your point, how this gentleman you were talking to...
Yeah.
This particular guy, just from talking to him, a lot of my very hardcore beliefs were confirmed, verified. But then I also had a lot of hardcore beliefs that were challenged in a good way.
But these were positive.
Positive challenges.
Beliefs.
Yeah. Yes.
Challenges.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like the mask thing. You know, I've always had been, when it comes to the mask mandates, I've always been 100% anti-mask mandate when it comes to just walking around outside, and I still am. Mm-hmm. But this guy raised some good points about business owners having the right to say, you have to wear a mask to come into my store, even though I don't necessarily agree with that, but I do respect their right to have their own personal mask mandate, I guess. He raised some good points about it. I still don't necessarily agree with what he said, but it helped me to think about it from a different angle so that I don't get so personally angry about it anymore. You know?
What that gentleman was essentially saying was basically, if you are a private business owner...
The government cannot tell you that you can't have a mask mandate.
Yeah,
or something along
those
lines.
They can't tell you you can or cannot.
Right,
and that it's solely up to you what you do
as the business owner,
because it's your liberty to do so.
Mm-hmm. Which fits into their platform.
Oh yeah,
it's small, less intrusive government.
Yeah, definitely.
And individual rights.
Right. However, I want to rebuff his argument because we talked a lot on our way home. Mm-hmm. And this is the conclusion I came to about the whole mask mandate thing. Yeah, businesses have the right to do whatever they want because it's an independent, you know, person who owns that business. Mm-hmm. That we all agree on as a libertarian concept in our country, you know, in our Constitution, that's what it is. However, I do not think that... it's part of your personal liberty to impose upon somebody to wear something which...
Because what about my body, my choice?
Yeah, my body, my choice. It's not your liberty to impose them wear a face diaper, which makes you contract bacterial pneumonia and lung cancer from prolonged wearing.
Because me personally, whenever I try to wear a mask, I mean, just cold hard fact, I cannot breathe as well.
Exactly.
And that's... And I've got asthma too, but it probably doesn't even have anything to do with asthma because I haven't had an asthma attack in a long time. But just when I try to wear those masks, I cannot breathe as well.
Yeah.
And I feel like even if I'm walking into someone's personal business and they're going to tell me you have to wear a mask, well, I feel like that's I don't have to go into their store, but I feel like that's an invasion of my personal liberty.
Because if it was a grocery store?
Because what if I, as a Christian, what if I had my own business and I told people, hey, you have to wear a cross around your neck to walk into my store? Mm-hmm. Obviously, non-Christians would be like, no.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what if I was a Muslim business owner and I said, hey, women walking into my store, y'all have to be wearing your hijabs or you can't come into my store.
Yep.
So see, it's like, where's the line? What if business owners start saying, hey, you have to bow down and worship Satan before you can come into my store.
Exactly.
So where exactly is the line here? That's what I struggle with. Like, I can understand to a point they're right to have their mask mandate thing, but it's like, where's the line?
Mm-hmm. The line is when there is no science that backs up that it protects you at all. And that's where we are with the masks.
Well, the thing, that's I go back and forth on science, though, too, because science is always changing to a point.
But
scientific understanding is always going back and forth with because people are always making new discoveries. Mm-hmm. You can't really base your values on science because science is always
changing. But there are certain constants in science. One of those constants is that masks don't protect you and they actually are harmful to your health.
And most people who've actually done their research would agree on that. But I still don't think using science is always a valid way to support or...
Right.
I'm having a hard time explaining
because of each person's perception of how they read science.
You need to work off of something that is objective.
Yeah.
Well, this is an objective fact, then. Let's go back to this. In 1918, during the Spanish flu, healthcare professionals found that people were dying from bacterial pneumonia from wearing masks. That was one of the prime contributors to the death back in the Spanish flu, was face masks, face diapers.
So you've got that historical scientific concept, too.
And that's why, ever since then, people have not worn masks. Why have we never worn masks up until COVID?
Yeah.
Well, it's because there was precedent that was set back during 1918.
That it didn't work. Not only did it not work, but it actually became more harmful than if they wouldn't have.
Yeah. The cure was more deadly than the disease. Mm-hmm. And so that's where we stand with the face masks.
And it's funny because I've heard that before, too. My girlfriend was actually listening to a podcast of a couple people she likes, and they were talking about how they used to wear masks back in the Spanish flu. And so, but then, like a few podcasts later or whatever, they said, well, we're wearing our masks.
Yep.
So it's like, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. You just said on a previous podcast that they don't work.
Yeah.
But then you're going to wear it. You're saying now we're out and we're wearing them. Why?
Virtue signaling.
Yeah, it's...
But this isn't about masks.
Yeah, I was good. About ready to redirect you guys back.
So, Libertarian Party is what we're talking about.
Libertarian Party. But you agreed with his principle on...
Personal liberty as a business owner.
I respected his ability to look at it from different angles, and it kind of helped me do that, too. And I that's what I gained from going to that convention, if nothing else. It was like it was kind of a nice little...
Brain workout.
Yeah, brain workout. It was good for me.
Okay. So you have an intellectual person, well-educated person, and you've got the free expression, and he's got some substantial ideas. Okay. And I know a lot of Republicans believe the same thing, except, like you said, they may be missing the target a little bit. Right. You know, they're not looking at it, the deeper layers of what the opposing infringement that is caused from a business forcing other people that come into their public business. It may in turn be an infringement. That's where you're maybe a little bit beyond the person you spoke with. You're thinking of more deeper.
We're kind of out of the box at this point.
Which I think is much better. So we've already found out that even in the Libertarian Party, some of the most intelligent people maybe have some biases.
Yeah,
and definitely. They're not thinking through these things deep enough.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, you know, you got two trash guys here.
Yep.
That are highly intelligent. They won't go around boasting about it, but they're capable of using common sense and the laws of nature and coming to conclusions that are a little deeper than even some of the Republicans, Democrats, and Libertarian people out there who think they've got it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but
so give you guys credit for that.
Well, thank you. Yeah. But with that being said, I think my biggest positive that I took away from it was, the intelligence of some of the people that we met there, and the professionalism of some of the people who spoke there, and their dedication to liberty. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it definitely seemed like they weren't just like, you know, they weren't just suits, you know, trying to, you know, get people to pay money to their party. You know, they like we talked to the guy who runs the LPTV channel on YouTube, and he was really cool too.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've apparently they're trying to set up this stream where they have different shows centered around the Libertarian Party.
Libertarian Party TV is what that stands
for. Yeah, Libertarian Party LPTV. LPTV. And they've got a Facebook page and they've got a YouTube. And so that was pretty cool that he came over and talked to us. Like, wow. he initiated conversation with us.
Oh, really? Yeah, he came over and was like, hey, how are you guys doing? And we're like, oh, hey, how's it going, man?
So,
what kind of shirts were you wearing?
I was wearing this one right here.
Okay. We were both wearing that shirt. Mask-free, allergic to tyranny.
We got. Oh, by the way, we got several compliments
yes.
About that, just walking around the city.
Yep. Yes, we did.
There were tons of people. Like, we like your shirt.
Yeah.
We're like, thank you. And Wesley, of course, Infowars.com.
Well, they always ask, where'd you get it? Infowarsstore.com.
But that's what's funny, though, is because as soon as you say Infowars.com, they're just kind of like, okay.
Yeah, they're like, okay.
Yeah.
They just immediately looked away.
Well, see, they're still, you know, they listen to the propaganda. Yes, you know, he was pegged as a conspiracy theorist.
Yep.
Yeah.
And the CIA has demonized so many people. Yep. I mean, it's been used so many times over. Yep. I'm so sick of the term, the label conspiracy theorist.
I am too, because we're all conspiracy theorists in the sense that we're all fighting for the same thing.
Exactly. So this is my message to the Libertarian Party, you know, to all the people who kind of went, oh, after we said InfoWars where we got the shirts. Even though they complimented our shirts, this is what I have to say to you. You're next. You're conspiracy theorists too.
Oh, I was seeing something on the news about CNN or somebody was saying, you know, we have to start considering all these people domestic terrorists, and the Libertarian Party was on the list.
Yeah.
Along with Trump supporters, along with mm-hmm. Christians, yeah. along yep. with lots of people.
So Libertarian know? Party, welcome to Alex Jones's boat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
By the way, I'd like to change conspiracy theory or conspiracy theorist to conspiracy analyst. So when somebody
conspiracy
does
analyst,
that,
yep.
We are conspiracy analysts. We connect the dots. And we are prophetic because of that. We can tell what's going on and what's going to happen to you.
Because conspiracies are a real thing.
That's what investigators do.
Yep.
They theorize first, and then they find the evidence, and they can connect the dots. Because why would a criminal want to get caught? Well, they're trying to cover their tracks.
Yep.
They can't cover all the tracks. So you get that information, you piece it together, you fill in the puzzle pieces.
Yep.
That is not conspiracy theory. That is conspiracy analyst.
But it's funny how it's become such a label, because it's become such a label that people don't even think about what the words actually mean. What do the words conspiracy theory mean? It means it is a theory. You have a theory that conspiracy is going on.
Exactly.
Yeah. That should not be such a negative label. That should be like, let's figure out what's going on here.
Isn't theory the beginning step of the scientific process?
Yeah. Well, actually, it's like you do all these experiments, you come up with your hypothesis, and then later on you form a theory as to why that happened, I think. Right. So it might actually be one of the later steps. But it is part of the scientific method.
Yeah, so there you go.
So we're blowing that out of the water. Don't call us conspiracy theorists anymore. Don't call Alex Jones a conspiracy theorist anymore. Yes. He's an analyst.
He is an analyst.
He's been right about everything.
Yep.
We're done with this.
Yep.
Just forget it.
Yeah, not to be violent with my words here, but if you call us conspiracy theorists, you will get an earful.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah, and it's about time.
Yep.
Yep.
So one of the other things we did at the Libertarian Convention that I was happy about is we brought a lot of copies of Alex Jones's Endgame Blueprint for Global Enslavement.
Yeah.
And we handed those out to people. We gave hard copies to some of the people that were interested. We gave one to the LPTV guy. We gave one to that lawyer who spoke there at the convention. And we gave some handmade, copies that you can make from a master. Mm-hmm. And we gave those out to a lot of people.
Yeah, I watched that back in the day. As a matter of fact, it was your dad that gave me Endgame. And I ended up showing it in the back room of the coffee loft.
Yep, I remember
downtown.
That was awesome.
And that was when everybody was listening to the whole conspiracy label, and you know, this was a difficult thing to sell, but there were people that went back there, they ate a meal and they watched this movie, and they all came out of there going, golly, this is this is dark.
Intense.
And they weren't even seeing everything yet.
Yeah.
Now they're seeing it.
Yeah.
And why would you still call Alex, person like Alex Jones, a conspiracy theorist?
Yeah, when his Endgame film 14 years ago predicted everything that's happening now.
Yeah.
Including the COVID lockdowns.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah. He connected dots, and that's what he did. And he's very aggressive about it, very, very rough with his opponents. And I think they need that.
Yes.
So why punish the guy?
Exactly.
So
don't shoot the messenger.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we had a very positive time. It was super duper fun watching all of their parliamentary proceedings.
Oh yeah, that was the funnest part of the whole thing, is all the parliamentary procedure.
Yep.
Did they have the gavel?
Yeah.
Yes, they did. And it was fun every time they hit it.
Oh yeah.
So they functioned like an actual government, basically.
Yes, I mean,
Robert's rules or whatever.
And hopefully
Robert's rules. Yeah. They spoke about that during the proceedings.
Hopefully this question isn't going to get us too derailed here, but I've always wondered why do American political parties use parliamentary procedure when our government is set up to be different than that?
Do you have to have some civil order? And so they maintained parliamentary procedure to keep people from killing each other.
Which was a good thing because,
well, yeah, of course,
the debates back then were really fiery in 1776.
Yeah, they were much more aggressive back then.
Imagine the entire room was full of Alex Jones.
Well, they didn't have microphones, so they had to yell.
Right.
Yeah, they did. But back in those days, I mean, they had duels. I mean, Hamilton died from an injury from a duel.
Yep,
that's what they did back then. It was a completely it was barbaric. It really was.
Right,
we're supposed to be civil today, and it's almost to the point of boredom when they're using these Roberts rules or what our government uses.
Yep,
I think it's a different one. I can't remember what it is, but it's similar to Roberts rules.
Yeah,
but it's just really boring and it's really slow because nobody ever gets emotional about anything.
Yeah,
they kind of keep it cool.
Yeah.
Try to anyway.
Yeah.
So what else positive that you took away from your experience there?
One thing that I really liked hearing them talk about is there was this one lady that was talking about prison reform.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
And basically talking, of course, I don't know, you probably know this, but the Libertarian Party is I wouldn't say they're pro-drug, they're pro-legalization of all drugs.
All of them.
All of them.
Even chemical.
Yes. Yes. Like cocaine.
Even heroin. Even cocaine. Even meth.
Yeah.
They are 100%. Let's legalize all drugs. And the reason is because, as they will tell you, the reason is if you go back to the history of the Prohibition when alcohol was illegal, there was just as much gang violence around liquor as there is now with drugs. Now today, now that alcohol is legal. When was the last time you heard of a liquor store owner shooting another liquor store owner for setting up shop right across the street? You know, I mean, the argument is that if you legalize things that you think should be illegal, like drugs or prostitution, if you legalize all that, people who want to get out of it can get out of it, and they're not going to get treated like a criminal for it. Mm-hmm. So I agree with their argument, their stance on that 100%, because I think, well, number one, it's one step further to getting the government out of our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And look at with human trafficking and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. If prostitution was legal, then people would not get enslaved into that. They would actually be able to get out of it. They would be able to get help or whatever they need, and they wouldn't get treated like criminals for it. They wouldn't get arrested. They wouldn't be sitting in prison just because they got trapped into that.
Mm-hmm.
So basically what you're saying is the libertarians, because of their, I'm not going to say liberty, I'm going to say freedom, the freedom portion of their platform, because I see a difference between liberty and freedom.
And there is.
Liberty is freedom plus morality, because you have to have constraints on your, you just can't do everything you want because you're going to end up killing somebody in the process or infringing on somebody else's rights. So you have to have a balance of a morality
and freedom.
With freedom.
Yes.
And that equals liberty.
Yes.
So just to be clear, freedom, the definition of freedom, that's like free will, right? That's like your ability to make your own decisions, your own conscious decisions. And then liberty is the ability to use that, but with
within a morality,
within moral guidelines, like what you were talking
about. To make sure that you're not infringing on another person's right to live without...
It's like, I have the right to swing my fist as much as I want until it comes into contact with someone else's face, then I have to stop.
Yeah, exactly.
Because then I'd be infringing your right not to get punched in the face.
Exactly.
Now, I think the Libertarian Party is mostly focused on marijuana. I think you're talking about a fringe.
Well, no, that was one. That was the chair who was talking about that.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Me personally,
I think it was the chair. I could be wrong, but it was the main guy who was gaveling.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the chair. My personal feeling on that is that marijuana, is not quite as hallucinogenic as some of the harder drugs. Mm-hmm. And if people are taking some of the chemicals in the harder, acid and things like that, the hallucinations could actually cause you to kill somebody with a vehicle or with a knife or a gun or so on and so forth. And I know a few things about hard drugs.
Right.
Marijuana is not, it's more like not even the equivalent of liquor.
Right.
Because I think liquor is dangerous too.
Oh yeah, much more dangerous than marijuana.
The only danger that marijuana poses to somebody is if you smoke it and you get high off of it, or if you ingest only THC and get high off of the THC, that high, that psychoactive effect it causes in the brain damages your short-term memory.
I've heard that, yeah.
And so, but what's interesting about cannabis and, and all the cannabinoids in the plant, which are medicinal, THC is, it treats only half of, all of these symptoms that somebody can be suffering from. And CBD only treats half. So what you need to do is you need to mix the THC and the CBD together. And what it does is then you are treating the entire circumference of the pie chart, but it causes something called the entourage effect to happen, where when you add them together, it eliminates the THC's psychoactive effect, but it doubles the medicinal property of both of them. Mm-hmm. And so that's why marijuana needs to be legalized, because if people can get a health supplement, which they can take sublingually under the tongue or, however they want to take it, and it's mixed both together, you're not going to get high. So you're not going to be, that's no longer a part of the equation, and you're getting double the health benefits from both of them.
Yeah. I don't believe government should ever criminalize the growing of a plant in the first place. Exactly. I don't care what plant it is.
Yeah.
It's the natural law.
Mm-hmm. God made it.
Yeah. You can't tell me what to grow in my garden or anybody else. Not that I would do that. I wouldn't, it's just not me, but I don't care if somebody, my neighbor, grows a pot plant over there and dries it, puts it in his pipe and smokes. I don't care.
Right. Now, I want to say that I would never condone anyone to smoke weed, even if it were legal. Just like I don't condone anyone drinking alcohol because it's bad for you.
That doesn't mean you think it should be illegal.
No.
You're just saying that you don't believe in it.
No. If you want to treat asthma, for instance, you would get a supplement, like I said, CBD, THC, tincture together, and you would aerosol it into your mouth and breathe it into your lungs. Instead of smoking it, that puts ash into your lungs. Mm-hmm. You would aerosolize it into your lungs. I'm theorizing this. You would aerosolize it into your lungs. The THC and the CBD and the entourage effect would treat your asthma, and you wouldn't have any symptoms because it treats that. And so does that mean I would stop somebody from smoking it? Like saying, no, you can't do that. No, I can't do that. But I would never condone smoking it because it's negative to your health to smoke it, both in the psychoactive short-term memory loss and the ashes in your lungs.
Okay. So just like liquor, if you're a parent and you have children growing up, you're not going to be pushing marijuana on your children. You're not going to be pushing your kids to start drinking alcohol. It would be the same thing.
Right.
But yet there's going to be people out there who eventually may want to smoke marijuana as a recreation or for medicinal purposes.
Right.
for the medical benefit of that, natural medical benefit of that. That's not for us to make illegal.
No.
And that's where the Libertarian Party, that's what their approach is when they're talking about marijuana, legalizing it. Plus, you know, marijuana right now is being tainted.
Yep.
And chemicals are being put in marijuana, and people are getting affected negatively by that. And it, you've got this black market going on, like you mentioned, the Prohibition era. Mm-hmm. It didn't work out so well, and it became more of a danger to people than if they legalize it. As soon as you commercialize it, then it's regulated and it's safe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you don't have criminals. Yeah. You don't have criminals, you know, putting stuff in your baggie or whatever, or your gummy, whatever they decide to put the marijuana or THC in.
Right.
For recreational purposes.
Right.
So you get rid of that, and then the criminals don't benefit financially.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. As soon as you make something illegal, there's automatically a black market for it.
Yeah.
And that's where the libertarian logic is coming from. Mm-hmm. Let's legalize all this stuff so that criminals don't have an excuse to be criminals with it.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Exactly. And then the price goes down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Then all these gangsters, they have no more reason to be shooting each other and you know, getting this big thing going because of all of it.
Yep.
Right.
But
we like, hope. We hope.
Well, that's in theory, of course, because I mean.
Well, I mean, it's a pretty safe, done deal.
I mean, because like I said, I've never once heard of anybody shooting someone over liquor.
Mm-hmm.
You hear all the time people shooting each other over drugs.
Yeah, because they're harder to come by.
Exactly.
Well, we all know, I'm just going to throw this out there. I don't know if it's true. It's a conspiracy theory that the CIA does not want us legalizing marijuana.
Well, and that's probably true, but more importantly, Big Pharma does not want us legalizing marijuana.
Oh, that's not true. Come on.
Oh, yeah, it's totally true.
Come on, Wesley.
Because if you could grow your own marijuana plant in your backyard, and if you could get the CBD and the THC out of it, you could treat whatever, you know, underlying health condition that you have.
You're a conspiracy theorist.
Yes.
Yeah, Wesley. Bad Wesley.
Bad Franklin.
So, yeah. Oh, my gosh. Yeah, that's good. Okay, so have we covered the positives of your libertarian perspective or your perspective of the Libertarian Party? Have we covered everything positive that you can think of?
Let me think.
For the most part, I believe we have.
Those were the major positive takeaways.
I'll just add one more thing. Basically, when we were actually listening to people speak and give their presentations, there wasn't a single thing I disagreed with. Mm-hmm. I agreed with it all wholeheartedly, and that's just me personally. Like the whole drug thing, I can definitely understand why people would be wary about their stance on that because, you know, drugs are dangerous and all that. And I would never condone doing any of the hard drugs. I wouldn't do it myself. I wouldn't want anybody else to do it.
No.
I just don't believe that the government should say, you can't do that.
Yeah.
That's my stance. And that's why I agree with their stance wholeheartedly on that.
Yeah.
So why, but, you know, you got users out there and they're addicted.
Mm-hmm.
Why would you want to incarcerate
exactly.
and criminalize
exactly.
these that's, people? They need help.
And that's why I was talking about prison reform. They were talking about prison reform. They were saying, look at all the people in our prisons right now that they're sitting in prison because they had an ounce of marijuana in their pocket mm-hmm. or they got caught with meth or heroin or something like that. I mean, do they need help? Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
But do they need to be treated like criminals? Do they need to be put in cages because of that?
No.
And what about all the murderers and the rapists that are running around out on the street? They're the ones who need to be locked up, not the people who are struggling with drug usage and stuff like that. You know, that's...
Yeah. But Franklin, come on. We have to have a war on drugs.
Yeah, I know, right? The whole war on drugs was started so that they could have this black market on drugs. Yeah. That's all it is.
The CIA has nothing to do with it. The government has nothing to do with it. Come on. They want to beat this thing. They want to complete this war on drugs. They want to win that war.
Right.
And they're doing that by sending guns to the drug cartels down south of the border.
Yes.
But we can't have guns.
No, we can't have
God
guns.
Forbid I have a gun in my house.
Yeah, because you're a white supremacist.
Not to mention, you know, guarding the poppy fields over in Afghanistan.
Yep. Oh, and all what were they? They were shipping back cocaine in all the body bags from Vietnam.
Oh, my.
Yeah, isn't that great?
Oh, that's another thing. I mean, some people are probably going to want to stone me for asking this question, but but I'd like to know. So being in possession of drugs like cocaine, meth, or it's illegal, right?
Right.
But then, so what ends up happening to it as soon as the cops confiscate it? It goes and it goes and sits in the police station for God knows how long. What are they doing with it?
Yeah. That's a good point.
You know, what do they do? I mean, it probably just sits in the police station,
right?
As evidence or whatever. But it's illegal to be in possession of it.
True.
Yeah. So, Mr. Popos, what you doing in there with it?
I thought maybe they turned it into the federal agencies.
That might be what they do. But then, what do they do with it?
But then, what do they do? Probably with
send it back across the border.
They sell it.
So it can so it can come back.
Probably, but they sell it first, like you said.
They sell it. They're making money.
Of course, they are.
Along with guns.
Along with guns.
Down to the drug cartels.
Yeah, you see, that's
this is the stuff I could get passionate and talk about all day.
This is all theory, though. we don't know anything.
Yeah, it's conspiracy theory. It's not facts by any means.
So we better, this is all a bunch of lies. Okay. So we better get back to the truth. You know, this is Verity Seeker.
Yeah, so watch CNN. Brian Stelter. That's real journalism.
Okay.
No, watch Project Veritas. Yes.
Anyway, did you want to get on to the
negatives?
The negatives. You want to go first?
Okay, let's...